Hi there, you're listening to Unnatural Selection, the show about newsy type stuff and things. My name is George.
My name is Tom.
And my name is Adam.
With our powers combined, we are Unnatural Selection. Make sure you visit us at our salubrious home on the web, unnaturalshow.com. It's a news and politics podcast, top story. News.
Katy Perry's new song.
Katy Perry's new single. Let's talk about it.
What the fuck?
No, has Katy Perry released a new single that people are mad about? Or is that
it
real?
It is called Women's World, and the opening lyrics are like, sexy confidence.
I think I did see something about
so
this.
So intelligent.
Yeah, it seemed pretty weird.
I've seen the promo image with her like robot boots and like
God.
Waistbands.
Yes,
I've seen the imagery.
guys, can I talk about what may be slightly more important news is an assassination attempt on Donald Trump?
I don't know. I think we should spend 10 more minutes on the Katy Perry thing.
Fine. No, I do want it on the record that Katy Perry image in like the centaur boots is awesome. It's a shame the song is trash. Anyway, yeah, Donald Trump maybe almost possibly had an assassination attempt earlier today, depending who you ask, because, you know.
How is it not an assassination attempt?
It seems.
I'm sorry.
It
was staged,
no.
Adam. It was all staged with crisis actors. I mean, even the alleged victim was in Home Alone 2. I recognize him. He's an actor.
No, that's so. It's so. Like, has our information environment really been so polluted that an assassination attempt on a former president, soon to be. Future president.
Current president.
Yeah, soon to be current president, if all the polling is to be believed. Surely we can agree on a thing that happened. Like, no, yeah. Even Trump is not dumb enough. He's too much of a coward to allow someone to, like, take a shot at him that he thinks is going to be. Like, allegedly, what looks like it's happened in the video.
Something like that, you wouldn't actually fire live rounds.
Yeah.
That's
so,
too risky if you were faking it.
Let's look at the video. Donald Trump, yeah, sort of you hear some popping and you see Donald Trump clutching his ear and sort of going to ground, and then a bunch of Secret Service officers come out and cover him, which, yeah, to be clear, definitely did happen. I don't know why Tom's introducing that element of conspiratorial thinking to it. Hang on. Got to switch the audio input. Edit, edit, edit. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Edit, edit, edit. Here we go.
Da-da-da-da-da-da. It's a bloody lot of shots. Yeah.
And then he puts his fist up. He's apparently, if you listen to the audio, he's asking about his shoe. He's like, wait, let me get my shoe.
Yeah, it's something weird like that. No. The reason I brought up the conspiratorial thinking was like, yeah, I woke up this morning to see like news, shots fired, Trump hit, all this sort of stuff. I hopped on the news just to be scrolling through it to be like, wow, this looks terrifying and crazy. And then I opened Twitter and the first tweets I see are just people in all caps being like, this looks like the most staged shit I've ever seen. I'm like, wow, that was quick. Like, we've already hit the did we really land on the moon? Elvis went back to his home planet kind of crazy thinking. Straight away. And yeah, my thoughts exactly, George. It's such an indictment on either our view on like mainstream news sources or how mainstream news sources and corrupt politicians have eroded the trust in our own damn lying eyes to a point where people are already questioning it like within seconds of it happening.
Yeah, if only there was a figure that would be primarily responsible for such an erosion of the information space that we could sort of pin all of this on, but sadly no such figure is That's available. Okay. So Donald, on an unrelated note, Donald Trump, it seems as though the bullet pierced the top part of his right ear. There was some photos that emerged of him sort of bleeding, and he was sort of taken off the stage by the Secret Service. There were some people that were dead at the scene.
Two people died. One being a rally attendee and the other being the shooter.
Yeah.
A few other people, I think, critically injured. They haven't released too many sort of details as to around the injuries of the rally goers and all that sort of stuff. Like, stuff is literally breaking as we are talking. Like, I think minutes ago, I see them saying that the shooter was a 20-year-old guy from Pennsylvania. They haven't said who they are, what their motives were. all this sort of stuff. They were on top of a building about 120 meters from the rally, taking the shots. Yeah, it's a lot to take in. Like, I had more plans.
Oh, you don't have a bunch of jokes? You haven't got some ha-has for political assassinations?
Yeah, I was quite glued to the TV this morning rather than, you know, getting along with my day, just being like, this is like, you know, it's one of those moments. I was too young to kind of realize it at the time with 9/11 and things like that, right? But where you're just like, oh, this is one of those days that they're going to be talking about for the rest of our lives.
Yeah, there's going, like, to be, you know, this is history that we're watching.
Yeah, this is history. Yeah. That photo of, like, the a lower down shot, Trump surrounded by Secret Service guys, fist raised in the air, blood down his face with the American flag suspended from cranes behind him, is going to be a famous image for the rest of history. Like, yeah.
Put it in horse race terms as though that's the only thing that's most important. But I think it was Omar from The Wire who once said, if you shoot at the king, you best not miss. And I think that really applies here in terms of Trump's political fortunes. Like, I think today's the day where he basically locked up the presidency, because I think in terms of the backlash that it's going to create with Trump's supporters, like, it's going to really motivate turnout. Because and it feeds into that whole line of argument that they've been pursuing. It fits into the line of argument that the Republicans have been pursuing in this election cycle, which is that, you know, they're coming after you and I'm the person that stands between you and them, you and the elites. And so, look, they literally, like, tried to kill me in order to silence me. And I think that line of argument is going to be pretty persuasive to a big chunk of voters.
Well,
like, I think we're going to look back at this moment and realize, between all of the, if you'd have told me a year ago that this election campaign was going to include Donald Trump getting convicted on 34 felony counts, a complete mental breakdown of Joe Biden at the debate stage, and an assassination attempt, presumably, on Donald Trump, and that the 34 felony counts was going to be, like, the least shocking part of that whole campaign, I don't know that I would have believed you. Like, America is too batshit for itself at the moment.
Yeah, the writers of this season, this final season,
it's really jumped
America
the shark.
Really gone crazy. Awful.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, there's too many plot threads to be tying up. They're introducing, like, new elements, like, right down to the penultimate episode.
This is the problem when you renew, TV seasons for multiple seasons in one contract. It's like, you know,
you go season by season, you know, keep them guessing.
Exactly right. But look, it's interesting. In terms of who shot who, it's kind of unclear at the moment. In terms of, like, you know, was the person who is wounded, was that the person standing behind Trump, like, in the background? Was the one thing I was thinking was, because there was a couple of shots that were the three that were fired by the initial shooter, and then a bunch of other ones ring out, which I'm pretty sure were Secret Service and other.
Fire back at them. Yeah.
And I'm did someone return fire and wound someone in the audience? Like, I'm not sure. We're not really sure at this point sort of how that breaks down.
Yeah. We won't for a while, probably.
No, I suspect they'll be, depending on what they can learn in terms of the political leanings of the shooter, I suspect they probably either will release it very quickly or they'll release it, you know, it'll be very carefully laid out, depending on, you know, who potentially may benefit from the story, shall we say, and the motivations behind it.
It's just been pretty crazy. I was yelling at the TV this morning when all the reporting was kind of coming in from, you know, various former presidents, from, like, George W. Bush, Clinton, Obama, everybody, and, like, everybody and their dog who worked in, like, the political space is, you know, messaging out, being like, political violence has no place in this country. Like, this shouldn't be a thing that's happening. Like, the you know, even if we disagree on things politically, these rallies should be safe. I'm like, cool, do schools next. Like, are you all gonna now, like, be like, hey, people shouldn't have guns?
Yeah, primary, like, school should be at least as safe as political rallies going forward. Yeah, I would,
like,
argue
Trump himself even posted on that Truth Social or whatever sort of thing, being like, you know, this this shouldn't happen in our country. I'm like, cool. Are you going to be taking people's guns? Maybe just people didn't have access to weaponry that they can shoot people.
Yeah, maybe if guns, maybe if you didn't have, you know, 300 million guns in the country, you know, maybe you could do something about it. But yeah, as head of the checks notes Republican Party, that's correct, not kind of been your bag. So
yeah, all that's, and also people saying political violence has no place in America when you kind of like founded on maybe one of the biggest acts of political violence
being a revolution. Yeah,
happened. Yeah, like having a revolution. Also, my wife Alice made a good point earlier today, being like, "Oh, it seems the revolution will not be televised; it will be memed." Mm. Because yeah, just everyone was immediately,
the revolution will be live streamed. In fact, yeah,
on X.
It's yeah, to say that political violence is not part of America's history is to neglect to have read any American history.
Yeah,
to just like as you say, like the violence and genocide visited on the Native Americans from when they first arrived, through to the violent revolution, through to the Civil War, through to labor rights movements being crushed by force, through to the present day Civil War. Yeah. It's just like American history is littered with acts of political violence, which isn't to say it's all right. Like, for legal reasons, we at Unnatural Selection do not support the killing of presidents or anyone else.
No, of course not. Especially because looking at this situation, like specifically with Donald Trump, it's like either, like what happened, you miss, and this is now just a piece of iconography that just clinches the presidency for him.
Yeah.
You actually killed him, and he's Franz Ferdinand. Like, that's when the Civil War...
And kicking off the First World War, you mean, yeah.
Like, yeah, yeah, that's what kicks off those crazy, like, nut bars who were listening to Alex Jones after the 2020 election, like, screaming for revolution and armed to the teeth. Like, yeah.
I might have
only two outcomes. Both terrible.
I might have to rent that Civil War film. It seems like more of an instructional guide at this point. So a friend of mine wrote me today. We were talking about this... you know, this news story. And he said, if you're going to shoot a president, and for clarity, don't, but if you are, make sure you kill them or you guarantee the opposite effect from what you intend. Yeah. It's like Reagan, like historically presidents that have had assassination attempts or had been assassinated, them or the people that remain in their stead tend to have like a pretty substantial rebound effect in the polls. Like Reagan became immensely more popular after his assassination attempt. You know, JFK's, the halo effect around JFK's assassination was enough to get LBJ to pass the Civil Rights Act, basically. Like that, otherwise, but for the fact that JFK was assassinated and he sort of translated that goodwill into political capital, that probably wouldn't have happened. So, like, don't.
Wasn't Ford or Carter, didn't they also get attempted assassination attempts as well? It's been a few presidents like that have had people try to kill them.
Obviously, Abe Lincoln being another famous example.
So it's like, it's funny, they had on ABC News, you know, since this kicked off, ABC News 24 in Australia, breathless coverage, as it is, it's a 24-hour news channel, so that makes sense. But
James Garfield, Abraham Lincoln, James Garfield, William McKinley, 1901. I didn't know about that one. JFK.
Oh, wow.
Obviously, Lee Harvey Oswald.
Is it a shorter list of presidents who haven't had an attempted assassination?
And attempted assassinations include Ronald Reagan by John Hinckley Jr., who got released recently. I remember seeing a story about that.
Yeah,
Teddy Roosevelt. The Teddy Roosevelt assassination story is crazy. I remember hearing a Dollop episode about this. It's like he got shot before a speech and then like proceeds to give a 45-minute speech whilst shot, before being like being forced to go to the hospital. Yeah, Teddy Roosevelt was a fucking G, I swear.
Yeah, and they don't make them like they used to.
And Donald Trump 2024. I remember there being a lot of talk about how, you know, Obama as a black president was going to be assassinated and they had to take all these extra measures, like putting tents. He had to like walk through like opaque tents to not be outside in various settings. So someone couldn't get a clear shot at him. Like, it's bad, obviously, but like, political violence has very much been part of America's story. I don't have a bunch of ha-has to make out of it. Obviously, like, I don't like Donald Trump. I don't like everything that he stands for.
I do find that the whole, like, I mean, obviously everyone has to deplore the violence, but the everyone wishing him well aspect is interesting given that, you know,
you're calling him fascist. a fascist 2 days ago.
Yeah, I think
that's interesting.
It's just tick the box.
But thoughts
it's
not, and prayers.
You know, thoughts and prayers.
Clearly, like a lot of the rhetoric around Trump has been like, if he wins, this will be the fall of democracy in America. Like that has been the line of argument from the Democrats, more or less. And I think there is an element of truth to that. Like what we saw with the Project 2025 plan that's, you know, sort of been rolled out, which is a combination of Heritage Foundation and the NRA and a bunch of like conservative boogeyman organizations, basically saying like, here is the playbook for how we are going to ruin America once Donald Trump is president.
Or whoever else. So like, even if you take out Trump, just the next guy will follow that manual.
Yeah, this is the manual for how to, you know, completely ruin the country. You know, I think it's there is some element of truth to that, but I think a lot of this rhetoric, I'm talking about Trump as an existential threat, which I think he is, but saying it and phrasing it like that clearly can pave the way to acts of political violence, which is not good. Trump needs to be defeated at the ballot box because, as you say, Tom, like, even if he was successfully assassinated, that doesn't solve the problem of Trumpism, which is a political movement, which could
millions of people
just as easily galvanize behind a new figurehead, you know, and proceed apace. Like it needs to be
becomes Republican Jesus, just like
he'll be martyred quite literally. Like you need to find a way of defeating them legitimately, and like whilst a lot of people hate Trump and are congratulating this person for trying to assassinate him, like you can't do that because the effects either way is not good for the country or democracy.
Yeah. Like, I mean, I wish Donald Trump would die, but I want him just to have like a heart attack or trip over a brick. I don't want someone to kill him.
I want him to choke on a Happy Meal like God intended.
Yeah. You don't want someone to kill him. Like seeing all these people being like, come on, man, you had one job. I'm like, we're all here for the funnies, but no, like if, like, I love a dark joke, but hey, man, if he actually killed him, there'd be, like, riots that would turn into fucking, I have not seen the film Civil War, but something like, it would turn in America into a war zone. Like, terrifying.
It's bad.
Mm. What a crazy thing to wake up to here in Australia.
Good morning.
Like, I woke up. It was one of those like bleary-eyed, look at my phone. It reminds me, actually, this seems to happen. I always like blearily wake up on a weekend morning to see the crazy thing happen. The same thing happened with January 6th in 2021. I remember like going, check my phone. Shots fired at the Capitol building. It was like the news alert. What's going on? Like, so.
It goes to show as well, like this is the, you know, former president, probably incumbent, but like, even this shooting happened, and there was a fuckload of security at this event. They had police. I think, I'm looking at one photo here from the ABC. They're saying that police snipers were the ones to actually return fire. So that they had guys on Overwatch. They had the Secret Service on the ground. And then what you saw on the news was a bunch of SWAT teams basically rock up. You know, well,
as a former president, he gets, I mean, even a presidential candidate at this level at this stage would still get Secret Service protection for that exact reason. But this is added because Trump as a former president has a permanent Secret Service detail anyway, but regardless of him running for president. So like,
but what I'm saying though is it's crazy though, where there's this level of security and there was a guy who still managed to bring a rifle.
It's because guns have human rights in America. There's so many guns. Like I'm surprised that this hasn't happened earlier or prior to this. Like
there was another attempt, or not an attempt, but there was a moment where Donald Trump got rushed off stage at one point, I want to say, in a rally of some kind. And I don't remember what the context was. I don't think it might have been a knife, maybe, not a gun. But there was a point where
I remember him being rushed off stage, but I don't think there were shots fired.
But I would love to see if this was the sort of situation to be like, guns are too dangerous to just be out and about. Like they could kill our special boy. But no, that of course not.
I'm pretty sure they
don't have the self-reflection to see how them saying like this shouldn't be happening in our country maybe directly ties to the fact that regular people can get access to AR-15s.
Supreme Court recently struck down the ban on bump stocks, so that was super cool as well. I don't know if you saw that.
Cool. I did not, but sounds great.
That was the point I was going to bring up. The Supreme Court recently passed a loosening of gun control regulation, basically. It's funny because, you talk to any of them.
Is it funny? You keep saying that, but it's like deeply unamusing.
Yeah.
It's, and like, but it, and borderline terrifying.
It's the cognitive dissonance of like, you know, I follow a lot of military sort of stuff on social media, and you look at the guys who are the Second Amendment guys who are just like, yep, no, it's absolutely our right to be able to arm ourselves to the absolute teeth to stop the Russians or just to protect yourself.
What's that guy in
Bowling
for Columbine who was like, yeah, I should be able to have a nuclear weapon if I want, like, right to my arms. Like,
protect my family.
Yeah,
with a nuclear weapon. But
mutually assured destruction with the Joneses across the street.
Yeah, yeah. If he trims my hedge one more time.
This motherfucker.
I'm going to nuke his house.
Yeah, like, I don't know. But they don't seem to understand that just because they're trained to use firearms doesn't mean that of the 300 million Americans, not all of them are going to be
and isn't
on the level, bro.
Yeah, like, isn't part of the wording.
Should everyone have a fucking Mack truck and that should be their personal commuting car? Yeah. Do I get to have my own killdozer, like, for fun? Because
isn't it part of the wording of the Second Amendment of, like, a well-organized militia?
Well-regulated militia,
yeah. It's the part that people always ignore. They see the right to bear arms but skip the part where it's like, you know, meaning people who are, like, trained and, like... Yeah, but like to have a resistance to tyranny, like to have the capability to resist tyranny in an organized.
Well, the whole idea was to have like there was no standing army back when that clause was written. So the idea was allow citizens to train up as part of these militias in order to repel the British if they come and invade.
If
the idea wasn't to have a fucking Glock when you go into the supermarket. Like,
when
that
you're
wasn't
arguing at Starbucks.
That wasn't the point. Like, America is a fundamentally broken country with regard to gun rights. And I'm surprised it hasn't happened sooner. And I wouldn't be surprised if we see more incidents like this, because I think, like, once you break the seal.
This will actually, like, in some ways, people will look at this and they will go, hey, this is the reason why we need guns, because that guy's got a gun, so I need a gun. And if everyone had guns.
If the entire rally was armed, I'm sure, everyone would have been saved. Like, yeah, that would have stopped the shooter. They might have killed many more people in the process.
Might have made it hard for the Secret Service to determine who, in fact, was the person to which they should return fire. But if everyone's armed and just, like, popping off, like, it's
the
Wild West.
George, the Secret Service would have a better means of being able to tell who they should return fire to if they also had more guns.
I see.
More guns is better for all situations, from what I've understood.
Meanwhile,
you got a problem, confused on your taxes, more guns. Dishwasher's broken.
Yeah. More guns.
Chuck some guns.
Yeah.
What's also interesting is that, like, every single person in that rally had to go through, like, a metal detector. Everyone was, like, you know, wandered. Like, it was pretty heavily scrutinized. In theory, you shouldn't have been able to bring a weapon into the event. But from what I understand,
it was 120 meters
outside
away,
the event.
The aerial shot that I've seen, I think, again, from ABC News here, was there were buildings. Like, so, yeah, the Trump rally was being held in the middle of, like, a, you know, flat grass oval or sports center or something like that. And about 120 meters away, there were more buildings just sort of nearby. And yeah, that's where they were. So
I just, I find it so hard to imagine that, like if the shooter, like, aimed, you know, 6 centimeters to the right, we might have just watched, like, a snuff film on live TV of Donald Trump getting his brains blown out. Like, it's actually fucking crazy to think about.
Yeah.
What, like, the alternate scenario of what might have happened. Like, I really do think, like, this proves that we're in the darkest timeline. Like, because
with certainty now, they ensured it.
Yeah. Like we have created an absolute, like, perfect storm of scenario, like, circumstances that will create maximum sympathy for Donald Trump, create maximum animus and confusion around his opponent being Joe Biden. Like, it is a perfect storm for returning him to power, and that terrifies me deeply. Like,
and, like,
emboldening the, like, resurgent
the
right.
They destroy the government.
They feel under threat now. You've just you've completely legitimized all of their batshit like deep state fucking conspiracies and concerns.
That people,
like,
want them killed for their beliefs. That's what I mean. Like, killing him or not killing him, both.
Taking the shot is bad.
To do this attempt to assassinate him, whether you're successful or not, there's no good result. So fucking don't. But you have now, so great. Thanks.
Now we have to live in the aftermath of the fucking timeline that you've created. That's great. Yep.
Cheers.
Meanwhile, probably to move to the next story, but it, I mean,
why? This is hilarious. Let's fucking hang out here for another 35 minutes.
Well, what's hilarious is that you cross the floor to Biden, and you know, he's not exactly doing himself any favors.
My son is napping in the next room, and I feel like you're doing this on purpose to trigger me, to make me yell.
What, okay. What am I doing?
Just
what am I doing?
Talking about Joe Biden. Like Joe Biden. You know that's one of my triggers.
Joe, what's his middle name?
Robinette.
Okay.
That's, actually?
Joseph Robinette Biden. Yeah, look it up.
Robinette Biden. Yeah, like this morning he got up and, you know, he had an immediate press conference in the aftermath. And
as soon as he woke up at like 8:45 in the morning. First thing, even after he had his dummy, had a bit of
He was probably on his way to bed. It was in the evening, so he was probably on his way to bed, and then had to like get it back, get out of his pajamas,
which is difficult because he just had solids, you know. So which is tricky. Mm. So he just been cleaned up. So,
but even then, you know, he said a couple of words and just sort of. Just didn't move his mouth, but made audible sounds.
Chuck a chip cookies.
But anyway, Democrat. But prior to this whole Trump thing happening, Democrats are splitting at the base, it seems, behind closed doors, but also not behind closed doors, just publicly.
And behind closed doors and behind open doors now, as the case may be.
As to whether or not he should continue on. And by all accounts, he's still going to. By gosh,
this motherfucker.
It really is turning into like, hey, Grandpa, give us your keys. We don't think it's safe for you to drive anymore. And they're like, no, I'll still be able to drive. Like, normally that's like quite a sad, tragic kind of thing. Because you're like, they're still trying to retain some autonomy. And like, I get that and I sympathize with that. But hey, like,
except
there are other
the car
on the road,
is not
the
like car is a 75 Buick. It's the nuclear launch codes.
It's a superpower.
So while Trump is now arguably now going to be at his strongest, perhaps the Democrats and Joe Biden are at their weakest.
I can feel my soul leaving my body. My soul is departing. Like I'm passing away.
Apparently there were a bunch of closed door meetings on Tuesday.
Just got a breaking update. So Reuters is reporting that the FBI has identified 20-year-old Thomas Matthew Crooks, there's always three names, as the subject involved in the attempted assassination of Trump. So presumably the shooter.
All right.
20-year-old man from Pennsylvania.
Okay, yep.
Cool. So that'll be a name that gets recorded.
Forever. In history. Yep.
In terms of the Democrats, they had a closed door meeting on Tuesday and basically came out of that meeting and everyone just started backgrounding. just backgrounding journalists. No one's being named.
Fucking Democrats.
But there's lots of people.
Honestly.
Like one of the quotes was that he was asked if the party was on the same page after a House Democrats meeting. Representative Steve Cohen of Tennessee quipped, "We're not even in the same book."
Just Dems in disarray. Just like classic. Unable to pull the thumb out and do what needs to be done. And, you know. Metaphorically, knife the leader, not actually knife. It's bad,
and just the way that some of them phrase it. Like, what do we got here? The Pete Aguilera, I think you want to say this. Aguilera, like chairman of the House Democratic Caucus, said right now President Biden is the nominee and we support the Democratic nominee that will beat Donald Trump.
Yeah,
so,
Nancy Pelosi
politician speak of being like, you know, oh, so do you think we should replace Joe Biden? It was like, Joe Biden is the current nominee and we support the Democratic nominee. Okay, so should that nominee change? It'll be like, we support the Democratic nominee. The Democratic nominee is Joe Biden.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's like
A equals B.
It's like V.
And B equals C.
Do you guys remember, as probably when we were in uni, so like, you know, 15 years ago now, but Bill Shorten was interviewed by, I think it was Sky News, and they were like, You know, do you have any comments, Bill, on what the Prime Minister has said?
I support what she said. This is about Julia Gillard, but he hadn't heard what she'd said.
I understand she's made comments on this in the last hour. I'm not exactly sure what she has said, but let me make it clear, I support what my leader has said. And then David Spears was the interviewer, and he's like, just to be clear, though, you haven't actually heard what the leader has said. He's like, yes, no, I haven't heard what she said, but you support it. Yes, I do. But how can you support what she said? He goes, well, let me be, I'm very clear here. I support what my leader has said.
Yeah, support what my leader said.
Let me be clear.
This is what she said.
And at the end of it, he goes, well, why is that? And then Shorten's like, well, I'm sure she's right.
Yeah.
It's just...
Anyway, Julia Gillard got cut from power, I think, about 3 months after that, but...
I don't know why you can just say, like, I'm not familiar with the comments. Like, I can't talk about it.
I haven't heard those comments.
Why did he even take the Sky News interview? I don't know.
Pod Save America guys seem to be on a campaign to, like, get Joe Biden to step down along with, you know, John Stewart and other prominent sort of, like, Democratic commentators. I think it was Tommy Vitor or one of the Pod Save America guys that said, everyone I've spoken to privately, like Democratic heavyweights, donors, everyone has said like they are concerned and they think Biden should step down. Now, what they're saying, some of those people are speaking publicly. Some of those people are still kind of like tap dancing around the issue, like Nancy Pelosi, where she's like, in the closet, hiding in the closet, come out of the closet. So, yeah, Nancy Pelosi, I can't remember the exact wording, but yeah, it's similar to that other statement that you said, Tom, which is like, you know, we need to ask if this is like a condition or like an episode for both candidates, but also like, you know, if Biden were to step down, we would support him and we just got to like wait and see how it goes kind of thing. Like, just like, she's not outright coming out and saying like, he should definitely step down, but it's like, you know, just tap dancing around the whole fucking issue. We all know what you're trying to say.
Just say something without committing to it.
Just fucking say what you're trying to say. We all know. We all saw. It wasn't one bad night. Don't tell me.
Yeah, well, no, it wasn't one bad night because earlier this week.
Lying to me and telling me that I didn't see what I saw with my own eyes. Who are you going to believe, me or your lying eyes? That's what the Democratic Party is trying to pull. And it's not working. There's like a bunch of polling that came out which talked about people who hadn't seen the debate rated Trump and Biden more or less evenly, okay, at sort of like 43 to 44, somewhere around that region. People who had seen the debate, you know, massively swung against Biden. Like Biden swang? Is that what's making you laugh?
No. A mass debate. Anyway, we're done now.
Mass debate. A mass movement in the debate. Yes, very good. You know, like people... The job of running for president, like regardless of whether you can currently do the job of being president right now, which I would argue you probably can't as Joe Biden, given what we're seeing, like the job of running for president is a job of communication. And it is clear from the information that we are receiving that the more he tries to do the running for president, the less people like him and want to vote for him. So like from a candidate perspective, that's kind of a bad sign. It's like the more people have contact with you, the less they want to vote for you. That's bad.
What were you saying, Tom? On Tuesday there was...
Oh, well, I mean, because last episode we talked about the debate, I think. Like the debate that was abysmal. But I think since then and now to now, there was the NATO summit.
NATO summit.
And then at the end of that, they were like, and Joe Biden's going to give a press conference. And now, Joe, this is the time to show that, the debate was a bad night. Like, tired, had a cold, whatever. But this is like, you know, let's show that that was an off night.
All right, Corn Pop, your time to shine.
And he's like, all right. And he's reading off a teleprompter. He's doing pretty well. Then someone asks a question about how he feels. And he says, well, I think I speak for myself and Vice President Trump. Keeps going and doesn't correct himself. And everyone's like, okay, on the first question, he's already said something real stupid. And he also introduces Ukraine's president, Vladimir Zelensky, as Vladimir President Putin. And then goes, Putin? I was thinking about beating Putin. He's going to beat Putin.
Oh, my God,
Putin.
Stop. You're Putin. Explaining stop. It makes it worse. What are you stop doing? Saying. Stop talking, you old motherfucker. Stop talking.
Yeah, he just fucking... And then I've seen other clips where... And I don't know, in the days of AI and deep fakes and all this sort of stuff, I'm like, did this really happen in the fucking press conference or not? But I don't know. But he was talking at one point and then he kind of stops and goes, I beg your pardon? To silence. Like, there was silence in the room as everyone's waiting for him to speak. Oh, and it's God. Like, he's like, I beg your pardon? I don't... well, okay, anyway, and just waffles on. And it was like, okay, what the hell is going on? Like, I saw some of the clips, like, introducing him as Vladimir Putin and Vice President Trump and all this sort of shit definitely happened. All the other bits, maybe not. But just, it looked terrible. It was like, yeah, let's do another press conference. This is the one that'll save us. And it was somehow even worse.
It's that it treads that, like, the worst case, like, darkest timeline scenario of being both adequate enough as a performance to prevent anyone from coming out with very strident criticism, but not so adequate as to, like, allay anyone's fears and, like, actually address the underlying concerns that they have about his age and cognizance and you know, like, cognitive decline. So it's like,
he got up and
so,
he said
so
words.
We're just gonna, this is what's gonna happen. We're just gonna muddle this way of people going, oh, I reckon maybe he could pull it back. Where it never gets bad enough that anyone actually does anything to remove him, but it never gets good enough to actually assuage people's fears. And it just treads this middle line and we get to November. And he just fucking loses. Like, I don't see the Democrats sacking up and being able to forcibly remove him. They're like, well, he's the nominee. What are we going to do? I don't know. You're the party. Fucking rewrite the rules. Remove him from power. 25th Amendment, well, his ass. Like, there has to be a way to remove him. Like, do you want to win? Mm. Do you think Donald Trump's an existential threat? Do you think you're going to lose to him? Everything points to yes. So either you take this seriously as an existential threat and you remove him, or you are going to lose, and the stakes are too high for you to fuck this up, you fucking weak-kneed Democrats. I cannot stand it. It's like sleepwalking.
Where the pressure may come is the financial pressure, right? So, and yes. The next story is
thank
that,
God for the billionaires. Is
that the leftist elite have started, apparently, pulling
voting with their wallets.
You can fuck with democracy, okay? You can fuck around, but you don't fuck with Hollywood money, okay? There's one thing you don't do is you do not fuck with Clooney.
Disney and Clooney will fuck you up. So yeah, Joy Clooney basically penned authored an opinion piece, basically, where he called for President Biden to step aside. A number of other key Democratic sort of celebrity donors or supporters, if you will, have started.
A lot of screenwriters. So, you know, that's bad. Yeah. They're going to be writing their op-eds and they're going to be snappy and well-written. And, you know, really going to make
so, yeah. I mean, you know, as to how much money that is in the scheme of the full Democratic
90 billion. War chest. No, well, I mean, yeah. I think they're expecting like the election spending to be in the billions this time around. So like 90 million is not going to sway things either way. But it's like,
there's the quote unquote political capital of celebrities, you know, drawing attention to them.
George Clooney has been like such a Biden stan. Like, he ran a campaign fundraiser for him recently. Like, and there's been a lot of stories like this coming out now over the subsequent weeks since the debate, where people have said, you know, things to the effect of like, oh, I encountered him at that debate. He didn't seem like he was like fully on top of things, but I thought it was a one-off. You know, there have been, you know, stories coming out of like people from within the administration saying that he's like, the last couple of months he has been slowing down. And I think people are going to see all this and they're going to think, hey, the administration or the Democratic Party has been lying to me. And if they're going to lie to me about something as serious as the cognitive decline of the president, what else are they going to lie to me? Like, you are turning off, you're turning off donors, you're turning off voters, you're turning off people who would volunteer and knock on doors and do the ground game, which is absolutely essential. You're going to ruin down, like, it's looking like it's going to have down ballot effects. People running for Congress in various districts are polling ahead of Biden in those districts. And so now they're distancing themselves from him because they don't want their campaigns to go under as a result of being associated with Joe. But like, it is a drag on ballots up and down the ballot. Like,
the other aspect, of course, is that, you know, since day one, since the 2020 election, and the campaign leading up to that, people were already like, that's been one of the Republicans' key call cards, is that, you know, Joe is slow, basically.
Sleepy Joe.
And that Sleepy Joe. Yeah. And that was one of their main things last election. And so that through line in the public consciousness has existed and as now exacerbated,
and it
doesn't the last
get
number of weeks.
Better. You don't get less old as time goes on. Cognitive decline happens.
Well,
and when it happens, it doesn't just like bounce back. You don't get younger every day. He's going to be 86 by the time his term would be over. People recognize, you know, they've got grandparents that have passed away or people have died. Like, everyone knows that 86 is too old to convert a PDF, let alone run the largest country in, you know, like the most powerful country in the world.
my point is that, like, it's not like this is a story that they can somehow manage.
It's not spinnable. I know what I saw.
It's been there, but it's persisted. It's been there, and now it's growing. And it's something that, you know, look. If for some reason, you know, if this hadn't been a conversation, like if you reset the clock and all of a sudden, like, this hadn't been a thing
out of nowhere,
like 4 years, yeah. It was just out of nowhere. Yeah, maybe he could survive that. You know, over a couple of months, you know, you have one or two good performances and all good. But the fact that there's already a public discourse around it means that this is now going to be the thing that defeats him, whether that's at the ballot box or whether that is, you know, prior to. So, I don't. I mean, I guess the only way around it is that you just have to have someone, the Democratic Party just has to have someone stand in opposition to Biden and then get the votes, right?
No, well, so what would happen is he would step down and presumably he would nominate Kamala Harris to be his representative instead. And then that way all the money and, you know, that's been donated and, you know, all these things that have accrued to the campaign can then just be handed over to Kamala Harris.
Can't another candidate just stand up and say, I want to do it instead?
No, I mean, you could have a brokered convention. This has been a whole thing, like the furious, you know, Twitterati commentariat over the last couple of weeks has been, you know, just masturbating over a, you know, a West Wing kind of Aaron Sorkin fantasy brokered convention type situation and what the possible
routes. And what does that mean? What does that mean?
So a brokered convention is basically where you have, and this is why they don't do this anymore. This is why they have primaries, because ever since 1968, where the Democrats had a brokered convention in Chicago, which is coincidentally where the Democratic convention is happening this year is in Chicago. So like the historical resonance be resonating. essentially what happens is you get, you know, people that are nominated, and then there's like a mini election in the room at the convention, and people sort of are brokering and wheeling and dealing and try and get their candidate pushed over the line. Think about it like,
and they use delegates, right? I'm assuming
delegates is the way of like, essentially counting votes as each person, you know, selected people are delegates. Now there's like super delegates, which is like a whole other thing. Their role has been reduced, like party officials and people who are like Democrat elites, what you would call, you know, people who have, you know, former elected officials and things like that. But then there's pledged and unpledged delegates. It's like a whole thing. But Biden would need to step down and then basically say, we're going to an open convention. And then that's what you go, you know, and then you have a sort of mini election, I guess, between now and then as to who the new candidate's going to be. Now, what happens then, though, is there are legal restrictions around the amount of money that's been donated to the Biden-Harris campaign can't then just magically be redeployed into a new campaign. So that's why I think that's a pretty unlikely scenario, because all the money, which is like tens of millions of dollars at this point, you know, would just essentially go down the tube. So I think the likely scenario is if Biden were to step aside, which I don't think he will at this point, he's just stubborn old man, just ruining his legacy at the moment, just becoming history's greatest villain by allowing Donald Trump to rise again. He would have to step down, and then Kamala Harris would have to step up. She would run and then, you know, presumably choose her own vice president. And then they would be the ones who would run on the new, like, Biden-Harris, you know, ticket, I guess. Harris something else ticket. That's the likely scenario if he were to step down. But like I said, I don't think he's going to, because he's too set in his ways. I just don't see it happening. And there's too much of like the Democratic, you know, like I said, Twitterati intellectual people arguing with each other over like, no, we just got to like support Biden. And like anytime we're, you know, talking about Biden to step down is like essentially encouraging people to vote for Trump. And so like they can't get out of their own like circular firing squad, the Democrats. Like, and so nothing's going to happen. This is what I think. Nothing's going to happen. And they're just going to shamble to November, and he's going to get walloped because no Democrats have got the sack to actually do what needs to be done and start publicly pulling money. Like, you're starting to see some of it now, but we're talking weeks later, you know, and I could easily see a situation where 6 weeks becomes 5 weeks, becomes 4 weeks, becomes, oh, it's too late. We can't do anything. We just got to go. We've got to dance with the one who brung you. And you're going to get destroyed. The Democrats are going to get destroyed. Like, I can see it all unfolding in front of me, you know, like there's no ripcord that you can pull anymore. Like, it's already too late. He's already lost. That's what I think.
That's not even considering the assassination attempt.
No, like, that's
without anything that happened today. That's
Kamala Harris is polling better against Trump than Biden is, but like not by much. She's still losing to him. Like, all of the candidates that people would think of as national Democrats with a presence to a national name ID to run for president are all still losing against Trump. Gretchen Whitmer, Gavin Newsom over in California, all of them are losing against Trump. Like, there's none of them currently.
And the risk is, though, is if they don't, if he doesn't do it soon, of course, then
the more you wait, the worse it gets.
Yeah, then no one gets a good run at it, right? Yeah. Like, there's enough time to build momentum, to have enough money donated or whatever else.
And this is with the Biden campaign essentially spending money in all of these battleground states and battleground districts basically unopposed for the last 6 months. The Biden money cannon has essentially been firing nonstop with TV ads and radio ads for multiple months at this point, trying to improve Biden's standing. And it hasn't been working. There's something like they've outspent the Trump campaign by like $90 million or something at this stage.
It's insane.
And the fact that it hasn't moved his numbers in a substantial way should tell you something, right? Like, and think about when the election campaign actually kicks into gear in the last 3-4 months, where they'll be getting Democratic messaging and Republican messaging. Mm. Like, that's only gonna make the problem worse for Democrats, not better. Like, they're already coming from behind. And the fact that no one's got the presence of mind to be like, okay, Joe Biden resigns tomorrow, and then Kamala Harris has, you know, 4.5-5 months to actually like try and get up, a bit of a run up. Like, she may not win, but it, like, at least she has a chance. Like, the longer you delay it, the worse that chance gets.
It's maybe they could. Americans should just change their constitution to the one in Australia, where we can just chuck a fucking spill in every 45 seconds and just stab the sitting prime minister in the back.
I was going to say, when they say this isn't enough time to change leaders, mate, we'll do it in an afternoon.
Watch and learn, boys. Like, hold my beer.
Yeah, holy cow.
They call winter the killing season in Australia, because that's when all the prime ministers get knifed. Politically, of course.
Because they said something fucked at the winter's ball.
Yep.
Metaphorically knifed, to be clear.
Metaphorically knifed.
Not actually knifed.
Yes.
Sometimes.
Spiritually and emotionally. Speaking of Australia, there's been some news this week that some Russian spies have been caught. And have been
alleged Russian spies.
Alleged Russian spies have been caught. Dom, you always have to ruin the moment with the.
You can thank me when you're not in jail or bankrupt.
Yeah, true. Yeah, I'll take that one. Kira Korolev and her husband Igor have been accused of obtaining Australian Defence Force material to share with Russian authorities, and they've been each charged with a count of espionage, which I think has a maximum jail term of like 15 years in prison. Yeah.
And it's this is the first instance of these charges being used. I think this was like new legislation from, I want to say, 2018.
It's like when you get a fun piece of tech. Yeah, it's like, oh, I got a new drone. Like, oh, goody, let's try it out.
Yeah. Like they legislated it, but this is the first time I think charges have been laid under the legislation. For this kind of count of preparing for an espionage offense. So what happened was so some context. This couple moved to Australia in about 2015, so nearly 10 years ago. They're Russian born, and Kira joined the Australian Defence Force, was a private in the Australian Defence Force. I think there's some other history in there where they showed like, oh, they're, you know, quite well traveled and like, you know, went around to all these places. They're piecing together, like, you know, I guess all their movements for the past decade, right? But the allegations are that she went back to Russia, and then while in Russia, contacted Igor, her husband, back in Australia to say, hey, can you like log on to my work account for me? Here's how to do that. I just need some things. Can you get those things and then send them to me while I'm in Russia?
Nothing and sus. Then
people thought, well, that you are hopping on to, I guess, the Defense Force VPN network and remotely logging in to get some classified documents, maybe. Mm. And I don't think they've sort of really announced like what they were thinking of accessing or any of that sort of stuff. But no. Yeah, but then to send it over to her and her to receive those documents while in Russia. And then I think they're just like making more allegations from there. I haven't sort of seen anything.
Undeclared travel as well. Like yeah. It wasn't like she sort of was on the sly sort of going to Russia. Do you know what I mean? Mm. Like,
yeah. I don't think they actually accessed anything and actually provided anything to the Russians and all that sort of stuff. But that there was at least they're alleging that they were planning to.
Just summering in Kamchatka, as you know, as most Australians do.
Hey, I don't know. I hear Russia can be very lovely, but I wouldn't go there right now.
Crimean Peninsula is beautiful this time of year.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what the government are alleging, what the charge sheet says for Mr. Korolev, it alleges that he had maintained a relationship with members or affiliates of the Russian Federation Intelligence Services for the purpose of sharing information. So they're not talking about, oh, yeah, I sent it to my second cousin, Dmitry, and he sent it to a crime boss. And yeah, because normally the Russians do things with like layers of...
They call them cutouts, you know, so yeah. Intermediaries with plausible deniability, and you might have several of those, right?
And so what they're saying is that, no, like this was a pretty direct relationship is what the prosecution is alleging anyway. They haven't applied for bail. Their matters are adjourned till September 20. I'm also not very clear as to, I'm not sure if you know, Tom, as to when this happened.
Well, I know they were arrested only like pretty recently, but
there was a neighbor that was their building manager who talked about police getting access to their property like within the last 3 months, and they only showed up in court Friday morning. So this is
like when was the actual offense, the alleged offense, is my question.
Well,
like, is this something they've been sitting on for like, you know, has the government been sitting on this? Was my point.
So it's not clear. So from the article, it's
at least for many months.
It's unclear how long they've been under investigation, but the building manager of the complex they lived in confirmed authorities contacted him around 3 months ago and he provided them keys to access their unit.
Oh, that's so harsh.
Well, he's legally obligated to.
I guess, yeah, if they've got warrant.
Yeah.
And all that sort of stuff. I thought a neighbor as well was like asked if they could use the neighbor's garage. He was like, okay. Use my garage for your sting operation. And of course there's all the comments of like, oh yeah, they seem nice, just kept to themselves. This is like just what anyone has to say about these people. But I thought, wow, it sounds like I've never sort of watched the TV show, but it sounded like the premise of The Americans.
Oh yeah, 100%. Like, oh wow, this they're just literally like people who are like, oh yeah,
these are our neighbors, they seem nice, they seem lovely. What they're spies? Like allegedly, but yeah, just reading about this, like, oh, you don't hear about this every day, that like maybe catching some covert operations going on.
Yeah, spoilers for anyone who's not watched the last season of The Americans. So
they are in fact spies,
that they are spies in America that get caught. Yeah, well, I assume that's I haven't actually watched the last season, so, but I assume they get caught. They gave off giving caught vibes at the end of the fourth season. So,
right, okay.
I assume that's how that story ends.
Oh, sorry, I guess slight correction. Ms. Korolev has lived in Australia for at least 15 years. So, sorry, I said 2015. That was only about 9 years ago. So, been here for longer than that.
Also, it's a bit of an age gap
between the two of them. Yeah. I didn't even clock their ages. I remember Igor was said to be 62. I didn't...
And she's 40.
Hey.
Do you reckon they're not married at all? It's just a... It's just
well, that's the plot of The Americans. Is like they're not actually a couple. They're posing as a couple.
They pretend to be an American family.
Don't they have kids? They've got kids in
they
that
do.
Show, though,
yeah, right? Well, you gotta do your duty for the Soviet Union, punch out a couple of kids, but they're not like actually in a real relationship. It's a fake relationship. Sort of
but like you've got kids, so basically you live together, so it's basically a relationship.
Or king and country. You
know, yeah, exactly. Like the whole, and that's part of the thread that kind of runs throughout it, is like during the course of the series, they actually kind of fall in love with each other, and it's kind of like complicates the loyalties and the relationship to the Russian state or the Soviet state, because now they have they have a family, which is a real family. They have a, you know, an actual love for each other. And that's kind of complicates, like, okay, well, you know, who am I really properly loyal to in this situation? Mm. But yeah, for the first, like, I think it was like 15, 20 years of the relationship, there was, it was just like a, this is the, in the American TV show, in the TV show. Mm. Yeah. They were just kind of like ships in the night. There was just like the whole having kids was basically just like a cover for them to be able to look like a normal family.
The look of a family. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. It's an interesting story. I really like the show. Anyway,
speaking of an interesting story,
this could be that or not. It could be something entirely different.
Entirely different. Yeah, but so that's interesting. Not every day you hear about maybe spies. Some international espionage being unearthed in Brisbane. And so
is it weird that this story is like fourth on the rundown, like with the crazy shit that's happened in the last couple of days?
Yeah, well, that's what I saw that happen and I was like, oh yeah, we'll laugh about Biden fucking said stupid shit again, but like, holy cow, like maybe Russian spies in Australia. And then of course this morning someone just had to try and kill Trump.
Yeah, it's
exciting actually. I don't know if we talked about it actually, but it was revealed that, and we did talk about it at the time, but there were a number of foreign, you know, people that were ejected from Australia as part of an ASIO like press conference. They give, the head of ASIO gets up and says things that make everyone scared sort of once every 6 months. And he sort of said, yeah, we removed a bunch of foreign individuals. And it was later revealed, and this happened about a month ago, I think, that it was Indian nationals that were removed. So the people that were spying on us in that instance were from one of our allies, which is concerning. But
the
Russian one's much more classical and much more sort of it's much more fun to say, oh yeah, there's Russian spies, and to sort of keep the goodies and the baddies squarely in the
it fits nicely into pre-established narratives.
Exactly. Whereas, you know, I think the truth is that everyone spies on everyone.
Oh,
you know, we've got spies in Indonesia,
we're
probably
on all our allies.
Oh, there was like,
I guarantee we have spies.
Oh, for sure.
Various neighbors. Yeah,
I remember there were stories about how we'd. I think it came out as part of the Julian Assange. We were like tapping the phones of what was his name? Indonesian.
In Indonesia,
Bang Yudhoyono, that guy.
We were like tapping the phones of like our Oceania neighbors.
Yeah, which is not cool. But I think the Indian thing was probably related to like there has been a bit of a rise in that kind of foreign spy activity, as we saw with that. And you remember there was like a Sikh leader in Canada earlier this year who was assassinated by like Indian secret services and stuff. So that's like,
we didn't do it. I was like,
yeah, it definitely did.
Canada was very adamant that it was, well, that there was a state hand in that happening.
So I think under Modi, I think the surveillance state and Indian Secret Service has been a lot more robust with their sort of extrajudicial killings and foreign operations and things like that, which is interesting that those are the, you know, the nationality of the people that were ejected. It's interesting.
Speaking of interesting, this next story is, it's a bit more than interesting. I mean, it's interesting, also disgusting. It's also curious. It's there's so many adjectives you could throw around it. George, you brought this story up. I don't know how you want to describe this, over to you.
We need to finish on something light.
George brought this up. As I understand it, your wife, Adam.
Yeah. Your wife messaged me to bring this up.
She didn't. So my wife messaged George, did not tell me about it. And George goes, oh, yeah, that story that your wife sent me. I'm like, what?
Because she knows who actually puts the effort into producing the show. And so she came straight to the source.
Yeah, that's fair enough.
And
we thank her for it.
And we thank her for her efforts. So there's a gentleman, probably gentleman's not the right word. There is a human male.
A loose unit
who's dressed almost exactly as you would expect in Sydney's CBD, who I don't really know how to. He pissed on some food at Woolies.
Yep, that's what it is.
Yep.
Yeah, that's essentially what happened at like 11:40 p.m. on a Monday.
It's caused $300 damage.
I can't believe he ruined all five of those apples. $300 worth of damage. Oh no.
Yeah.
several hours for workers to decontaminate the area.
Yeah.
I mean, look, you know, after a few frothies, I've definitely walked into some areas and gone, I really need to wee, but I've always managed to make it either outside or to a bathroom.
Hmm.
Now, I don't know what this guy's sort of, what his story was leading up to this. I am curious. Like, was this a, I'm angrily going to piss on the apples, or was
was this a protest? A protest like, against the cause he lives?
I mean, I could see that. Yeah, I mean, so is there a guy dressed all in black? You know, he's got a sort of like a, you know, like a hoodie on, a backwards back baseball cap. You know, black jeans. Is as an as yet unidentified individual between the years of 20 to 30, and yeah, he just came in, took his dick out, and then pissed on a bunch of produce at Woolies. On Monday. I don't know why the Monday thing is like of note for me, but it's giving like
11:40 on a month. Like, you know, if it's because like, you know, if we're going with the generous read of, oh, someone's having a big night on the piss. They're just like really,
definitely on the piss.
Really. They're really drunk.
Not a Monday night.
We're like, I need to pee and just go wherever they happen to be. Cause they're just so pissed. You'd be like, oh, on like what, like at 2 a.m. on a Saturday morning on Chapel Street or something? You'd be like, yeah, of course. There'd be people hammered like, oh, God, they must have to put up with that all the time. But
it would make more sense, I would think. Yeah.
You're a bit like, you could at least just excuse it for, oh, man, that guy must have been having a big night. So maybe this guy was having a really big night, but it's a really big Monday night, which is different. If we follow societal norms of the Monday to Friday work week, if you know, in gig shift economy, like Monday could be this guy's Saturday. So
maybe it was a targeted attack. You know, like some people want to shoot former presidents, other people want to piss on some apples at Woolies. Like, you know, each to their own.
It's a spectrum.
Yeah,
it's a spectrum.
I want to say, like, what kind of apples were they? Like, was it like Red Delicious,
Royal or Gala,
like Royal Gala? Like, there definitely are some like. I don't know what you call them, makes of apples. No, what are they?
Brands?
Like types of apples.
Species of apples.
Species of apples. That are inferior, like that aren't good.
Pink Lady.
Yeah, definitely.
The tang that I like, not the urine tang.
Yeah, I was going to say, give me Pink Lady or give me death. Like, because, that is an apple.
Yeah, well, we were a Fuji house growing up and my father would not abide Pink Lady apples.
Wow, so, okay. Damn. Okay.
All right. Well, I guess we can't be friends anymore then. Golden Delicious or get the fuck out.
Golden Delicious. I had a hankering for Golden Delicious as a child. So I mean, these were definitely Golden Delicious after this man was through with them.
I can't believe I didn't put that together.
Close the show.
On that note, we always will be our Natural Selection. We're not going to do better than that. Make sure you visit us at our salubrious home on the web, unnaturalshow.com. Make sure you follow us on all the bullshit social medias that have, do, or ever will exist at our handle at Unnatural Show. That's Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and mother flipping TikTok. Make sure you follow me on Twitter and Instagram at George Tsipos.
You can follow me on Twitter at Tom D. Heath.
And you can follow me down to the local Woolies where I will be buying Pringles.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep. It was anti-comedy, so I see what you did there. So you made it seem like you were going to say, like, just, going to take a, obviously don't piss on produce, like, but just some sort of, like, geyser.
Some joke about pissing on.
And then you just said something about Pringles instead, which is anti-comedy.
An inverse,
I mean, it's probably easier to more cleanly, like, piss in a Pringles can than it would be just on all the vegetables.
Well, certainly your aim would be better. You know,
but also imagining saltier.
a kind of a sprinkler situation, just to, you know.
Yeah.
Anyway, the show's ended ages ago. I just thought we'd just like keep chatting, you and me. So
Cool and normal.
How about them Mets?